Audible Inc. presents Jimmy Stewart is Dead, Ending the World's Ongoing Financial Plague with Limited Purpose Banking. Written by Laurence J. Kotlikoff. Narrated by Christian Rummel.
Forward by Jeffrey Sachs. Larry Kotlikoff is a worried man on an urgent mission. He knows that the financial crisis that hit us in 2008 can come back with a vengeance because our government so far is treating the symptoms but not the underlying disease. By the time you finish this book, you will be worried too. With brilliance, wit, clarity, and bravery, Kotlikoff explains how our financial system is virtually designed for hucksters. Yet even more importantly, he shows us how to fix it. As Kotlikoff makes clear, the litany of faulty incentives and opportunities for fraud in the U.S.'s banking system is distressingly long. Limited liability, fractional reserves, off-balance sheet bookkeeping, insider rating, kickback accounting, sales-driven bonuses, non-disclosure, director-sweetheart deals, pension benefit guarantees, and government bailouts. It's a system, in a word, in which bankers make promises they can't keep in order to collect outsized earnings unrelated to real productivity. What a cast of characters we will meet along the way. Kotlikoff is right to note that most bankers are fine people doing their best by their clients. But he is also right on the mark to note that the top ranks of bankers include a remarkably large number of fast-talking con artists, riverboat gamblers, and highwaymen. And why not? With regulatory loopholes a mile wide, the con artists have found ways to abscond with tens, even hundreds of billions of dollars before the entire economy went over the cliff. I've taken my own special interest in the bankers' bonuses over the years, as I've witnessed up close how rather pedestrian Wall Street work on restructuring developing country debt could pull in millions of dollars in fees for the bankers. At the start of each calendar year, I've gone slack-jawed at the level of Wall Street year-end bonuses roughly equal to the total worldwide aid given to 800 million Africans. At a recent dinner with bank executives to discuss African poverty, I surmised the depth of their concern with this heartbreaking issue as they steered the conversation to the relative size of their wine cellars, with several describing their collections as exceeding 30,000 bottles. The typical African could spend his whole life working and never afford a single one of those bottles. These are signs not merely of moral decadence, but of regulatory collapse. Kotlikoff skillfully leads us through the various methods that the banking leaders have developed for taking their slice of the assets. Amazingly, none of the executives who we meet in these pages was technically equipped to understand the deeper risks in which they were placing their firms and the world economy. But they were very well trained in cutting themselves extremely generous proportions of the action. If Kotlikoff had stopped at explaining what just hit us, he would have performed a mighty service. Even with the many vivid and entertaining accounts of the great crash in 2008, of who said what to whom on the fateful weekend in September 2008, when Lehman, AIG, and Merrill hit the wall, no previous book comes remotely close to this one in offering a conceptual understanding of what has gone wrong. Through ingenious examples and stories, Kotlikoff gently instructs the readers in the core concepts of financial economics: coordination failures, moral hazard, intergenerational accounting, principal-agent problems, Ponzi schemes, and much more. It is our great fortune, though, that Kotlikoff does not stop there, but proceeds boldly to lay out a novel, powerful, and ingenious set of reforms under the rubric of limited-purpose banking. As he explains, the motivation of LPB is to limit banks to their legitimate purpose, connecting borrowers to lenders and savers to investors, and not let them gamble. But Kotlikoff is no scold. He's not against gambling per se. He's only against others gambling with our money without our knowledge or permission. This is the protection of LPB. If individuals want a completely safe bank account, their bank deposits will be matched 100% by money held by the bank. If they want something riskier, or some form of insurance, then appropriate mutual funds will be available to cater to distinct needs and set up in ways to avoid systemic risk. In all cases, financial intermediaries will face not 115 different regulatory agencies asleep at the wheel, but a single federal financial authority with a very limited assignment to ensure that fund managers do not abscond with our assets and immediately, fully, and accurately disclose what each fund is holding. Imagine that, a financial marketplace in which we're actually told what we're buying. Kotlikoff traces some of the origins of his ideas to proposals for limited banking that emerged in the wake of the Great Depression and which have won the endorsement of leading economists over the decades. He does not shrink from pointing out continued controversies surrounding his ideas, so that the book provides an ideal jumping-off point for further serious debate over the ideas. There are lots of open questions and areas of doubt that require further discussion, notably around the issues of how fast, how far, and in what ways we would need to adopt LPB to reap its benefits. Still, the ideas are powerfully resonant and will find a growing group of adherents. America is passing through a very difficult economic juncture, with high unemployment and even higher anxieties. Millions of people have seen their financial security lost in the Wall Street tsunami. We feel adrift, with a large majority sensing, correctly, that the country is headed in the wrong direction. Faith in the economic system, the lifeblood of the economy itself, has been badly broken. Kotlikoff knows that each of us bears a responsibility and has a role to play to help repair the damage. With characteristic directness and integrity, he says that every economist has an obligation to focus on this economic emergency. Let us thank Kotlikoff for a clear, convincing, and highly original call to action. With this book, he has surely fulfilled his obligation and much more to help the world reset its sights on a more stable, fair, and prosperous economy. Jeffrey Sachs, Director of the Earth Institute, Quetelet Professor of Sustainable Development and Professor of Health Policy and Management at Columbia University.
Preface. 'Twas the year the country stood still. Not a car, truck, or bus rode the roads. No one drove to work, no one drove to shop, no one drove to visit, no one drove anywhere. The reason was simple. No one could buy gas. The gas stations had all gone broke. Their owners had tired of netting pennies on the gallon. They wanted to surge their earnings. The big money, they learned from a bright young MBA, was in securitizing their services. So they started selling gods, gas options for drivers. Each god gave the driver the option to fill her tank for $4 per gallon. Drivers bought gods religiously. And with gas selling for $3 a gallon, station owners didn't worry. Then the unthinkable happened. Gas prices skyrocketed to $6 a gallon, and drivers began invoking their gods. Each god could save $2 per gallon per tank, and if you didn't need gas, you held up a sign, "Gods for Cash." Station owners began cursing the gods. They now had to buy gas at $6 a gallon and sell it for $4. In short order, the owners went bust. They closed their stations and started looking for jobs in financial services. Gods became worthless. Overnight, there was no gas for the nation's 250 million vehicles, and the economy ground to a halt. The economic moral is simple. If you want markets to function, don't let critical market makers, intermediaries who connect suppliers, for example, refineries, and demanders, for example, motorists, of essential products, gamble with their businesses. Apply the moral to banks, shorthand for all financial corporations, including insurance companies, and the regulatory prescription is clear. Limit banks to their legitimate purpose, connecting lenders to borrowers and savers to investors, and don't let them gamble. Would that we had heeded this injunction. Instead, we let Wall Street play craps with our financial system, our economy, and our tax dollars. The result? We lost big time. This book describes in plain English and simple terms the big con underlying the big game. the web of interconnected financial, political, and regulatory malfeasance that culminated in financial meltdown and brought us to our economic knees. It's a story with everyone on the take, with a host of villains committing first, second, and third degree economic murder, leaving millions upon millions of victims at home and abroad. Others have told and are telling this story. They're primarily financial journalists and Wall Street traders. Their insider details are both fascinating and horrifying. But conveying the facts is not the same as assessing their economic meaning. That's primarily the responsibility of economists, of which I am one. We economists are charged with understanding and protecting the economy. We're supposed to spot economic disasters before they arise and recommend solutions. Unfortunately, we failed in our fiduciary duty. With rare exceptions, those of us manning the watch, the economists hired by the government and the business world, missed what was coming, were shocked when it happened, exacerbated the public's fear, and are now helping resurrect the system that failed so miserably. The rest of us, academic economists like myself, were perched in ivory towers, too high above deck to see the pervasive financial malfeasance that was underway. We had a clear view, had we looked, but we were researching our imaginary world in which people play by the rules. Consequently, we had even less clue that the nation's largest financial companies, aided and abetted by the rating companies, politicians, and regulators, were madly driving our economy straight toward the rocks. They reached their destination. The economy is now firmly on the shoals and in ongoing danger of completely breaking up. Given that our economy is in DEFCON 1, or very close to that condition, it's all economic hands on deck. Every economist has an obligation, regardless of her or his area of specialization, to focus on this economic emergency, to understand what really went wrong, and to help make sure this never, ever happens again. This book is my attempt to help us escape the rocks, and not just for a quarter, a year, or a decade, but for the long term. The years our children and grandchildren hope to enjoy. To be clear, my main area of expertise is not finance. It's fiscal affairs, particularly the sustainability of our tax and spending policies and their implications for the next generation. But I've also worked on a range of other issues, including economic growth, saving, international trade, pensions, insurance, health reform, tax reform, social security, and personal finance. Studying a range of economic issues provides a broader perspective for considering the problem at hand. It also helps to be clear of financial conflicts of interest in weighing Main Street's interests against Wall Street's. In my case, my bread isn't buttered by financial companies, but by an independent academic institution, namely Boston University. Unlike my economic brethren working on Wall Street and many of those working in Washington, I don't need to worry that what I say will affect what I earn now or in the future. I'm also free of political constraints. I'm not a registered anything and am beholden to neither political party. But full disclosure requires full disclosure. Breadth, distance from the street, and mostly armchair policymaking come at a cost. The more we know about everything, the less we know about anything. In my case, I'm not an expert on all the intricacies and imperfections of asset pricing, exchange trading, risk appraisal, dynamic hedging, and securitization. And I can't quote line and verse from banking regulations or tell you precisely how to construct a CDO squared or other exotic derivatives. Fortunately, for the critical matter at hand, fixing our financial system, seeing the forest is much more important than naming all the trees. My goal, then, is not just to survey the amazing and disheartening events surrounding our economic shipwreck, but to convey their deeper economic meaning, particularly the extraordinary danger of maintaining the financial status quo, and to propose a solution that follows from the terrible facts. The right financial fix, called limited-purpose banking, is remarkably simple and easy to implement. And it can be accomplished without limiting credit, risk-taking, insurance, leverage, or any other economically vital financial behavior or service. Most important, limited-purpose banking will immediately restore trust in our financial system. which is the sine qua non for reviving the economy and its long-term prospects. This financial fix is wholly different from the policies pursued to date to rescue the banks and insurance companies. Those policies have administered elixirs when the patient is in cardiac arrest. They've made the patient more comfortable, but done nothing to cure his underlying disease. Worse yet, the palliatives are extremely expensive and highly addictive. The gurus applying these cures have a vested interest in preserving the status quo. Their focus is on the next election, and far too often, their next job. What they've ignored is the next generation, which can neither afford their solutions nor tolerate their tinkering. Young, trusting economic lives are at stake, and nothing short of economic open-heart surgery will save the American dream. Our sad tale, with its hopeful ending, starts with our economic disaster and where it's headed, describes its causes, identifies its architects, and then shows how to fix our financial system for good. Laurence J. Kotlikoff. Chapter 1. It's a horrible mess. Each financial crisis is different, yet they all feature financial institutions making promises they can't keep. This is a sure bet. My strategy beats the market. This loan is AAA. Our capital's adequate. Your money's safe. Don't worry. Well, we're worried. The financial market has melted down, and with it, trust in a system that routinely borrows short and lends long, guaranteeing repayment yet investing at risk. It's a system virtually designed for hucksters, with limited liability, fractional reserves, off-balance sheet bookkeeping, insider rating, kickback accounting, sales-driven bonuses, non-disclosure, director-sweetheart deals, pension benefit guarantees, and government bailouts. It's a Wonderful Life, the beloved Christmas movie, showed just where this can lead. An otherwise honest banker, George Bailey, played by Jimmy Stewart, confessing to a mob of angry demand depositors that, in fact, he'd lied, that Bailey's savings and loan can't return all their money on demand. Despondent and about to take his life, God sends an angel to save George and his bank just in the nick of time. The movie's ending is happy, but its underlying message is not. Our financial system, as designed, is fantastically fragile, perched atop a pillar of trust that can instantly be undermined. Check that, was undermined. For here we sit with our financial pillar in ruins, watching Uncle Sam desperately trying to glue the pieces back together. It's not Bailey savings and loan. Uncle Sam's strategy, fight each financial fire one by one and rebuild the old system pretty much as was, is deeply misguided. It treats the symptoms, not the disease, and will leave us financially and fiscally weaker. The financial community has close ties to Sam, marked by massive campaign contributions to both parties, and is working overtime to make sure Sam doesn't rock their boat. Their mantra is, "The financial crisis was caused by a housing bubble, spurred by the Federal Reserve's low interest rate policy and lax regulatory oversight. The system is fundamentally sound and critical to our economy. We haven't seen anything like this in 80 years. Yes, some bad apples took on too much leverage, but trust us, we're doing God's work. We'll make sure it doesn't happen again. We bankers know what we're doing, and our financial judgment is critical for allocating credit and choosing investments." The notion that bankers know what they're doing or can keep this from happening again is risible, given everything we've seen. And the proposition that banking as usual is essential to our economy, as opposed to extremely dangerous, is predicated on a quaint view of banks that bears little resemblance to today's reality. Bailey's savings and loan is not your local bank. Your local bank is Bank of America, Citigroup, J.P. Morgan Chase, or one of the other 10 largest banking conglomerates, whose headquarters are hundreds, if not thousands, of miles away, and who have taken over most of the banking business. And Jimmy Stewart, the honest, warm, kind, and trusting soul, is not your local banker. Jimmy Stewart is dead. Your local banker is some underpaid clerk who's been in place for 6 months and knows nothing about you, your family, or your business, and frankly could care less. His job is not to apply personal knowledge in deciding to lend you money or call your loan. His task is to plug your credit rating, income, loan request, appraisals, and other data into a computer and tell you what the computer tells him, namely how much you can borrow and at what rate. Our bankers are desperately attached to the current system for good reason. It lets them socialize risks and privatize profits. Socializing risk means having the public take the hit when things go south. Privatizing profits means earning big fees in normal times when the economy generates positive and high returns on investments. This is by no means to suggest a conspiracy of bankers, but rather to point out that bankers, like members of other professions, are self-interested and have managed to set up a system that works for them, even if it doesn't work for the country. Nor do I imply that bankers, as a group, lack financial judgment, integrity, or a social conscience. Most are fine people doing their best by their clients. But their ranks, particularly their top ranks, include a remarkably large number of fast-talking con artists, riverboat gamblers, and highwaymen whom you'd never trust with your money, let alone your kids, if you really got to know them. Both the good guy and the bad guy bankers are working within a regulatory system designed in the 1930s for Bailey's savings and loan, not for today's world of global finance, exotic financial securities, computerized electronic trading, and enormous trade volume that George Bailey cannot begin to fathom. Today, more trades are conducted on the New York Stock Exchange in a single day than were conducted in all of 1929. The new technologies have not only increased the speed of financial transactions, they've also reduced the costs. This translates into better terms for those needing to raise money by selling assets, for example, borrowing or issuing stock, and higher returns for those willing to supply money by buying assets, for example, lending or purchasing stock. But as the spreads to intermediation got squeezed, many financial players started looking to make money the old-fashioned way. By stealing it. Some of this theft involved simply pocketing investors' money, with Bernard Madoff and Alan Stanford being prime examples. But most involved selling snake oil, including complex bundles of incredibly crappy, to use technical language, mortgages, which were stamped AAA by the principal rating companies, Standard & Poor's, Fitch, and Moody's. The rating companies delivered their appraisals in exchange for huge payments. And after verifying that these mortgages had been insured by AIG, MBA, or some other malfeasant insurer, which the rating companies had themselves rated AAA, the complexity of these securities, the implicit bribing of rating companies, the deceit of mortgage initiators, the incompetence of regulators, the sales-based compensation of management, the complicity of corporate directors, the collusion of bankers and politicians, and the naivete of investors all quickly turned the sale of snake oil into a multi-trillion dollar industry. The collapse of this industry has exposed our financial system for what it is, fundamentally corrupt, incredibly fragile, and never again to be trusted. Unfortunately, there is no putting the genie back in the bottle. We can't return to yesteryear and outlaw what has become a $600 trillion market in derivatives. Yes, you heard that right. We can't eliminate the securitization of loans, bar financial innovation, or expect global bankers to act in loco parentis. We can't ban subprime mortgages, credit default swaps, collateralized mortgage obligations, or other so-called toxic assets. Nor can we limit credit only to those with good ratings, stable jobs, and plenty of collateral. In short, we're stuck with financial modernity for better and for worse. But as we've seen, financial modernity goes far beyond what our old financial regulatory and rating system can handle. It's also far beyond what Uncle Sam can handle. His decision to bail out the banking sector, the mortgage industry, the insurance industry, the money market fund industry, the auto industry, the credit card industry, the states, the housing industry, the student loan industry, small business, the RV industry, the rental car industry, the boating industry, the snowmobile industry, and Lord knows who's next, invites ongoing gambling at the public expense by any business or entity that can reasonably expect a bailout if push comes to shove. This is a prescription for fiscal insolvency, which could culminate in hyperinflation, as the government finds that the only way it can get enough money to cover all its handouts is by printing it. The printing presses are already running overtime. The monetary base measures the amount of money Uncle Sam prints in order to buy things, whether those things are financial securities, tanks, spaceships, or lunch for the president. On January 1, 2008, the monetary base totaled $831 billion. On June 1, 2009, it stood at $1.8 trillion. Uncle Sam printed more money, just shy of $1 trillion, over those 18 months than was printed in the entire history of the Republic. And he's just revving up. The Federal Reserve has pledged to print another $1.75 trillion during 2009 to lower long-term interest rates and thereby continue to bail out the economy. That translates into more than a quadrupling of the monetary base in 2 years and could, if banks start lending again, culminate in a quadrupling of the nation's M1 money supply and ultimately of prices. The authors of this policy know they are playing with fire. The economy could quickly flip from experiencing today's low inflation or even deflation to hyperinflation. The policy's chief architect, Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke, is an exceptionally thoughtful, responsible, and cautious person, not to mention an outstanding economist. The fact that he's pulling out the stops to this unprecedented extent speaks volumes for the gravity of the situation. But throwing money at the problem is no long-term solution. It does nothing to fix the system's underlying problems, which requires tough love, not endless handouts. The right path forward is not exhuming Jimmy Stewart, applying some makeup, and propping him up in the bank window. Given what it's learned and lost in this financial debacle, the public would no longer trust Jimmy Stewart in the flesh, let alone the bone. The right path forward is limited-purpose banking. Limited-purpose banking is a real, as opposed to cosmetic, fix of the financial system. One that gets and keeps Uncle Sam off Wall Street's hook. Such a fix is essential not only for healing the financial sector, but for achieving overall economic recovery. By itself, the financial sector accounts for over 20% of U.S. GDP. And like gas stations, its operations are vital to the rest of the economy's performance. But no one is going to rely on financial companies if they can't trust what they are doing and selling. Wall Street has completely and irrevocably squandered the public's trust. And left to its devices, Wall Street will keep chasing the almighty buck, no matter the risk to the economy, including a rerun of the Great D. Talking Turkey with Wall Street. Boys and girls, the party's over. You have one job and one job only: financial intermediation. If you want to gamble, be our guest. But do so on your own time, in your own home, and on your own dime. As a group, you are not to be trusted. So we're going to let you exercise your significant skills and generally good judgment, but in a way that doesn't threaten our savings, jobs, and families. From here on out, you'll have to work within a new financial system, called limited-purpose banking, that makes you stick to your legitimate purpose, financial intermediate. Look around. The only part of your industry still standing is the mutual fund industry, which generally stuck to its knitting, connecting suppliers of and demanders for funds. The reason is simple. Mutual fund companies, with a few exceptions, didn't play craps with their company's capital. Limited-purpose banking transforms all of the financial corporations in which you work, whether they are called commercial banks, investment banks, hedge funds, insurance companies, private equity funds, venture capital funds, brokerages, credit unions, or something else, into pass-through mutual fund companies. None of your companies, which we'll just call banks, will ever again be in a position to fail, because none of your banks will ever again be allowed to borrow short and lend long and leave the public to pick up the pieces. The public ultimately bears the risk of investment, and the public, with your proper help, is going to decide what risks to take and what risks, including systemic financial collapse, to avoid. All banks will be subject to the same regulation, regardless of their particular line of business. A single federal regulator, the Federal Financial Authority, FFA, will verify, disclose, and supervise the custody and independent rating of all securities held by all mutual funds. This will put an end to the pervasive fraud that now attends your initiation and sale of vast numbers of securities. Economics Diary, Spring 2009. The D word. Depression is a word that no economist likes to say. But today it's on the tips of everyone's tongues, and for good reason. The economy is imploding at a rate we've not seen since the 1930s. Output is dropping at a 6% annual rate, exports are off 15%, and the financial system is on life support. The only industry doing well is the breadline. Food stamp applications have hit record highs, and one in three of our nation's children are now on this dole. More than 500,000 workers are losing their jobs each month. Close to 1 in 10 Americans, some 12.5 million people, are now out of work. Housing starts are at 50-year lows, and foreclosures are at all-time highs. 2 million families lost their homes last year because they couldn't pay the mortgage. Another 17 million may shortly join their ranks. Everyone is scared. The jobless are worried sick, and those with jobs are sure they're next on the chopping block. The elderly are in acute shock. Many have seen their retirement assets fall in half and their dreams of a comfortable retirement evaporate. Our children are feeling our pain and asking us what happened. Our answer is that we don't know. We thought we had well-functioning banking and insurance companies with competent directors, world-class managers, responsible regulators, and incorruptible rating companies. But overnight, we learned it was a sham. That while we were hard at work, much of the financial, regulatory, and rating system was busy producing, whether intentionally or not, trillions of dollars worth of assets we now call toxic. One financial giant after another has crashed to the ground. They've either gone broke, been forced to reorganize, had to raise equity at fire sale prices, been fully or partially nationalized, been bailed out, or changed charters to garner FDIC insurance protection. Countrywide Financial, Bear Stearns, IndyMac Bank, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, Lehman Brothers, Merrill Lynch, AIG, Washington Mutual, Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, Citigroup, Wachovia, Madoff Securities, Bank of America, and Wells Fargo are the most prominent U.S. financial companies to fully or partially hit the skids. Abroad, Northern Rock, UK, HBOS, UK, Royal Bank of Scotland, UK, Lloyds, UK, HSBC, UK, Barclays, UK, Grupo Santander, Spain, Fortis, Netherlands, Hypo Real Estate, Germany, Glitnir, Iceland, Gulf Bank, Kuwait, Svyaz, Russia, UBS, Switzerland, Credit Suisse, Switzerland, and many others have met the same fate. In the face of this serial financial failure, Uncle Sam, to his credit, swung into full gear to fight the emerging economic war. But his actions, plus the actual or effective collapse of so many major financial players, scared the bejesus out of us. In declaring economic war, Sam never said the D word, but made sure we knew that the great D was a good possibility if we didn't give Wall Street trillions of dollars to fix its mess. The more we worried, the more we stopped spending. Being frugal became chic, and demand for non-essentials like cars and vacations dropped like a brick. Suppliers responded by cutting production and employment, which reinforced our fears. A negative feedback loop ensued. Just how negative remains to be seen. In scaring ourselves, we scared the rest of the world, and so the economic contagion spread. Iceland, Russia, Brazil, Dubai, Germany, name the place and see the wreckage. Spain's unemployment rate is now at 17%. Japan's exports have fallen in half. Sweden's industrial production is down 9%. Particular sectors and parts of the United States have been absolutely clobbered. New car sales are off 37%. General Motors has gone bankrupt, and so has Chrysler. Ford is struggling to stay afloat. Circuit City has short-circuited. Linen and Things, Mervyn's, and the Sharper Image, all history. Home Depot, Target, the Boston Globe, and the New York Times are looking shaky. The airlines are registering huge losses, and until recently, were selling fewer tickets than they did way back in 1984. They're now canceling half-filled planes with the frequency of Eastern Airlines. Even ExxonMobil is facing tough times thanks to a massive decline in the price of oil, which has now rebounded somewhat. Major U.S. companies, including Motorola and Forbes, have stopped matching their workers' 401k contributions. Unemployment has reached 13% in Michigan, 12% in Oregon and South Carolina, and 11% in Rhode Island, California, North Carolina, and Nevada. Las Vegas, where one in every 14 homeowners is being evicted, has a new nickname. Sin City is now Foreclosure City. In their desperation, people are going for broke, actually for more broke, by playing the lottery. Lottery sales are up across the nation. But people are buying hope on the cheap. Their trips to the casinos are way down. Atlantic City, which recorded 28 straight years of rising revenues until spring 2009, has seen its revenues plunge. The racetracks are also suffering, but by less. This May's Kentucky Derby's total handle was off only 5%. From their peaks through December 31, 2008, stock markets around the world have melted down, wiping out some $30 trillion in worldwide equity holdings. The S&P 500 fell 42%. The London exchange fell 34%. The French exchange fell 48%. And the German exchange dropped 41%. Asia, too, was creamed, with the stock markets in Japan, Hong Kong, Australia, Singapore, India, and China plunging 52%, 54%, 47%, 55%, 53%, and 70%, respectively. Brazil's market lost 49%. Russia's market dropped 68%. Canadian stocks fell by 40%. South African stocks fell 35%. And Irish stocks fell a whopping 77%. In the United States, the leading indicators of the contraction, house prices, are now off 27% from their peak. Yet house prices are still heading south, with another 20% decline still likely, at least in my mind. As it is, U.S. household net wealth has declined by $13 trillion since the second quarter of 2007. Economics Diary, August 22, 2009. Much can change in 4 months. The index of leading indicators, an early gauge of economic growth, has risen 4 months in a row, and house prices are, it seems, beginning to head up. But other data don't look so good. 1 in 8 homeowners with mortgages is now in foreclosure or behind on payments, and 1 in 5 is now upside down on the mortgage. That is, the homeowner owes more on the home than the home is worth. New claims for unemployment benefits are running close to 600,000 per week. The unemployment rate in Michigan is now 15%. 14 states have unemployment rates above 10%, and the FDIC just seized Guarantee Financial Group, Incorporated. This is the 10th largest bank failure in U.S. history and the 105th bank failure since the financial crisis started in the spring of 2007. Guarantee Financial is a serial bankrupt. It went under during the S&L crisis in 1988, when it was called Guarantee Building and Loan. With federal help, it reopened under its current name, growing its assets to over $18 billion, and its Texas and California-based branches to 150. Starting in 2005, Guarantee plunked down $3.5 billion on AAA-rated, option-adjustable-rate mortgages. Mortgages that give borrowers the option to decide, each month, how much to pay. 2 in 5 of these mortgages are now delinquent. Not surprising. The people who took out option ARMs were short on cash and wanted to dramatically lower their payments without dramatically lowering the quality of their housing. They figured their homes would appreciate by the time their payments went up. This would let them either sell the house at a profit or refinance, taking out their newfound equity to cover their now higher payments. At the peak of the housing extravaganza, option ARMs were a very big deal in certain places. They accounted for 40% of mortgages in Salinas, California, 25% of mortgages in Naples, Florida, 51% of mortgages in West Virginia, and 26% of mortgages in Wyoming. Back on September 11, 2006, Business Week worried out loud about these mortgages in an article entitled Nightmare Mortgages. Yet it ultimately blessed them. But the Wall Street pros who buy option ARMs are in the business of managing risk, and no one expects widespread losses. They've taken on billions in iffy option ARMs, but the loans are no shakier than the billions in emerging market debt or derivatives they buy and sell all the time. Blow-ups are factored into the investing decision. Guarantee Financial is no longer one of the Wall Street pros in the business of managing risks or managing anything else, for that matter. Guarantee Financial is now dead and hopefully won't be resurrected with yet another name and another winning business strategy. But there are hundreds of dicey banks still operating, meaning we're likely to see hundreds more bank failures in the near term. Even though many bank stocks are on a tear, albeit from extremely low values, banking analysts are giving failing grades to almost 2,000 of the 8,164 FDIC-insured institutions. These banks aren't formally insolvent in large part because they're using phony accounting to stay afloat. For example, the banks are using a reporting gimmick to report as revenue what the option ARMs would pay were the borrower to refrain from exercising the option not to pay. That is, the borrower may be handing the bank $5,000 this year, but the bank can legally report it's receiving $10,000. For some banks, assets producing such phantom income constitute well over half of their reported assets, where reported means carried on their books. The Treasury's no-stress stress test. The Treasury recently conducted a stress test to determine if the 19 largest banks could make it through the next 2 years. Many observers were astonished that the Treasury looked out only 2 years, and they felt that it bent over backward to paint a rosy scenario. To pass the Treasury's test, big banks had to be able to withstand a 9% loss on the loans they've made without violating their capital requirements, their financial cushion against losses in the value of their assets. It appears that losses have already reached this 9% level. If the economy picks up, or if banks can generate a bigger cushion by selling more equity, shares of stock, the system will likely get by. But if neither of these things happens, look out. According to economist Michael Pomerleano, one of the world's foremost experts on banking crises, the banks are continuing to make phony calculations based on wishful thinking and could easily be overstating the true value of their assets by $1.5 trillion. This means we could see banks reporting $1.5 trillion in losses in the next year or two. The FDIC insures 8,246 financial institutions with $13.5 trillion in assets and about $1.3 trillion in owners' equity. So a $1.5 trillion write-down would devastate our reeling banking sector. Economics Diary, August 26, 2009. The State of the States. The states are going deep into the red. As a group, they are on a course to run a $350 billion deficit over the next two fiscal years. Compared with last year, state personal income tax receipts are down 7%, state sales tax receipts are down 3%, and state corporate income tax receipts are down 15%. Hawaii has put state workers on a three-day-per-month furlough, in effect cutting their pay by 14%. Maine, Rhode Island, Maryland, and Michigan have gone further. They've simply closed all non-essential state offices on Fridays. Colorado's doing the same, except on Tuesdays. Altogether, some 20 states are furloughing their workers or closing state offices for part of the week to save money. There's more. Maine is now taxing candy and ski lift tickets. Kentucky is taxing cell phone ringtones. The Massachusetts legislature wants to raise the state's sale tax by one quarter or introduce casino gambling in some of the seamier parts of the state. My candidate would be the Capitol building. There's plenty of space, and the politicians can keep an eye on the House take. Georgia is thinking more creatively and considering a poll tax on strip club patrons. Arizona is contemplating running bingo games and bringing in slot machines to increase severely strapped state coffers. Delaware is now running sports betting. Illinois has stopped paying for funerals for the poor. Oklahoma is reducing visiting hours at its museums and historical sites. Wisconsin is raising the cost of elk hunting licenses. Washington is laying off teachers. New Hampshire is selling state parks. And California is considering taxing its largest cash crop, marijuana. California just passed a $25 billion package of budget cuts after endless political deadlock. The cuts include furloughing state employees, from DMV workers to UC Berkeley professors, long enough to affect a 10% salary cut. It's also releasing prisoners early, closing 200 state parks, and printing its own money, called California State IOUs, which promise to pay 3.75% tax-free interest. To date, California has printed 194,000 such IOUs, with a face value of $1.03 billion. If California remains underwater, it will need to print more IOUs so that it can come up with the $1.03 billion to cover the initial IOUs. California's IOUs aren't legal tender as far as Uncle Sam is concerned, so don't try sending California IOUs to the IRS to pay your taxes. And good luck depositing your IOUs at the bank. The big banks are saying thanks, but no thanks. But the IOUs do have market value. Investors are offering anywhere from 65 cents to 95 cents on the dollar for IOUs on Craigslist. If California was fully trustworthy, the IOUs would sell for more than $1. Indeed, for about $1.03, thanks to the interest they bear. Enforcing its creditors to accept IOUs worth at most 95 cents on the dollar, California has effectively defaulted on its debt. Yes, California may eventually pay back every dollar it owes, but if it doesn't pay back what it owes when it owes it, it's not paying what it owes. The possibility of receiving a given amount of money 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, and so on from now is not the same as getting that money today, for the simple reason that were it received today, one could invest it and earn interest for sure over the period. As the eighth largest economy in the world, California may feel more entitled to print money than other states. But if California can print money, so can Delaware, Maine, Nebraska, and any other states. Soon, we could have 50 state currencies circulating. A nice throwback to the early days of our country, when each of the original 13 states had its own banknotes. And if the states print their own money, what's to stop local towns and cities, and even individuals, from doing the same? Nothing. During the Great Depression, some $1 billion in new currencies was issued by towns and cities, as well as school boards and wealthy individuals. Most of the IOUs were written on paper, but certain new monies had peculiar backings. Some were stamped on metal. Others were written on pieces of spruce. Some were engraved in leather. Some were registered on pieces of discarded tires. And some were printed on fishskin parchment. There are big problems with everyone and his mother printing his own money, not the least of which is counterfeiting. During Argentina's financial crisis in the early 2000s, all 23 of its provinces began generating hordes of their own script. This made the Argentine central government nervous about fakes. So the government took the remarkable step of using its own presses to print the provincial currencies. Each province was free to order up as much fresh money as it wanted, and bingo, it was delivered. It's the psychology, duh. The worst part of all this is the overhang of anxiety. A world that freaked out once can do so again. And short-term improvements in economic conditions don't guarantee prolonged, stable growth. The "it that should not be named" of the 1930s lasted a decade, notwithstanding two expansions generating rapid growth. Watching venerable, rock-solid financial behemoths collapse, one after another, has transformed the impossible to imagine into the sure to happen, and left everyone looking over their shoulder. British economist John Maynard Keynes referred to collective anxiety as animal spirits, which references another word economists are loath to use, psychology. We economists like to think of ourselves as hard scientists, even though few share our conceit. And down deep, we think of psychologists as medicine men. At least, we used to. We now realize that psychology is critical to the functioning of our globally interconnected economy. Indeed, macroeconomists have spent the last two decades developing models with multiple equilibria, featuring coordination failures, in which confidence, emotion, psyche, feelings, call it what you will, dictate how the economy performs. Recall Bill Clinton's 1992 campaign slogan, "It's the economy, stupid." Were he running today, he'd be proclaiming, "It's the psychology, duh." Because the collective fear is palpable. The reality of our economy is little changed from December 2007, when the D/R thing began. We have the same physical and human capital, the same equipment, factories, homes, apartment buildings, stores, skills, and people. What's different is the degree to which all these inputs are being used together. Adam Smith's marvelous invisible hand, which is supposed to turn self-interest into social well-being, has failed miserably. Self-interest is very narrow-minded and can just as easily coordinate on bad rather than good outcomes, equilibria, persuading us all to sit on our hands. It's tough selling your products to the unemployed. The bad equilibrium to which we've now switched involves no one hiring because everyone thinks, has coordinated his or her beliefs on the idea, that no one else is hiring and that there won't, therefore, be much demand for goods and services once they are produced. Were everyone to suddenly believe the opposite, that times are good, hiring would kick back in and this alternative belief would become self-fulfilling. This is where President Obama and his hard-working economics team may be helping. Their cautious confidence and hyperactivity in announcing new policies to fix the economy may help change economic opinion, even if the policies themselves are deeply misguided. The reason that beliefs matter so much is that we don't have anyone matching demand and supply. Adam Smith isn't sitting in a rowboat in the middle of the lake shouting to Alex and David on opposite shores that now's the time to swim to the middle so that Alex can swap his fish for David's hot dogs and vice versa. It's a long, cold swim with heavy bundles to tow, and neither Alex nor David wants to jump in the water if the other party isn't going to show up. The lake's quite wide, and neither person can see or hear to the other side. One option is for each to simply eat what he has. But Alex is sick to death of fish, and David hates hot dogs. They'd sure like to get what the others got, but they'll end up eating what they hate without something visible, a huge pep rally by the president or even a sunspot, to coordinate their icy plunge. When Lexington, Massachusetts turns into Camden, New Jersey. Flipping to a bad equilibrium as big companies fail and psych out the public is the largest cost of bankruptcy, but far from the only one. If we could costlessly move managers, workers, and capital from one concern that goes bust to another that's thriving, having companies die wouldn't be such a big deal. But that's not the case, even in our information age. It still takes time and money to search for a new job, and not everyone can telecommute. Many of the unemployed have to move to a new town, a new state, sometimes a new country to get back to work. And getting the buildings and equipment of one company sold and reused by another can take what seems like forever. I grew up in Pensauken in New Jersey, right next to Camden. My father, Harold, and his two brothers, Tanfield and Albert, owned Camden's first and last department store, called Kotlikoff's. It was started in 1909 by my grandfather Lewis. In the 1970s, all the big department stores, including Sears and Penney's and Litt Brothers, closed their doors, and no one came in to open them. Instead, as you drove through Camden, more and more of its storefronts, as well as its homes, went from inviting to boarded up. Campbell's Soup is still headquartered in Camden, but most of Camden's manufacturers pulled out of Dodge and simply abandoned their factories. This was neighborhood effects at their worst, with no new businesses wanting to open up next to others that were boarded up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.